condition. Then you see it come to fruition. That's a type of resurrection. When you turn off the light and go to sleep at night, bury your head beneath the covers. Arise in the morning, oh, that's just another type of resurrection. So I know that he lives, my Redeemer lives. I know. Tell me, do you? Yes, I know that he lives, my Redeemer lives. I know. He gave me all the proof. Yes, I know that he lives, my Redeemer lives. This I know. How about you? How about you? Israel ate that lamb, then left Egypt's land to the Red Sea, oh, Pharaoh right behind them. Through divided waters, Yah delivered them on dry land. That's a type of resurrection. Old Joseph was a dreamer, his brothers did despise. They put him in that hole, for they sought to take his life. Then he was lifted up by the merchants passing by. That's a type of resurrection. So I know that he lives, my Redeemer lives. This I know. Tell me, do you? Yes, I know that he lives, my Redeemer lives. Oh, he lives. He gave me all the proof. Yes, I know that he lives, my Redeemer lives. This I know. How about you? How about you? Abraham was faithful, took his son to sacrifice. Then Yahweh said, you please me, you don't have to take his life. Then he turned around to see the ram Yah did provide. That's a type of resurrection. Oh, a type of resurrection. Oh, 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 oh. Now all these types and shadows truly testify that Yahshua has risen, that Holy Spirit that gives life. I don't have to sit and wonder if he is alive, 'cause he said, I am the resurrection. I am the resurrection. So I know that he lives, my Redeemer lives. I know, do you know? Yes, I know that he lives, my Redeemer lives. I know, do you know?
Good evening, class. I will be reading from the Holy Name Bible containing the Old and New Version of the New Testament, Old and New Testaments, critically compared with ancient authorities and various manuscripts, revised by A.B. Trainer with the Scripture Research Organization. I'll be reading Romans, the 8th chapter. There is therefore no condemnation to them which are in Yahshua the Messiah, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. For the law of the Spirit of life in Yahshua the Messiah hath made us free from the law of sin and death. For what the law could not do, in that it was weak through the flesh, Yahweh sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh, because of sin, to condemn sin in the flesh, that the righteousness of the law might be fulfilled in us, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. For they that are after this flesh do mind the things of the flesh, but they that are after the Spirit, the things of the Spirit. For to be carnally minded is death, But to be spiritually minded is life and peace. Because the carnal mind is at enmity with Yahweh, for it is not subject to the law of Yahweh, neither indeed can it be. So they that are in the flesh cannot please Yahweh. But ye are not in the flesh, but in the Spirit, if so be that the Spirit of Yahweh dwell in you. Now if any man have not the Spirit of the Messiah, he is none of his. And if the Messiah be in you, the body is dead because of sin. But the Spirit is alive because of righteousness. But if the Spirit of him that raised up Yahshua from the dead dwell in you, he that is raised up Yahshua from the dead shall also quicken your mortal bodies by his Spirit that dwelleth in you. Therefore, brethren, we are debtors not to the flesh to live after the flesh. For if ye live after the desires of the flesh, ye shall die. But if ye shall through the Spirit do mortify the desires of the flesh, ye shall live. For as many as are led by the Spirit of Yahweh, they are the sons of Yahweh. For ye have not received the spirit of bondage, again to fear, but ye have received the Spirit of adoption, whereby we cry, Abba, Abba, Father, my Father. The Spirit itself beareth witness with our spirit that we are the children of Yahweh. And if children, then heirs, and heirs of Yahweh, and joint heirs with the Messiah. If we suffer with him, we may be glorified together also. For I reckon that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us. For the earnest expectation of the creation waiteth for the manifestation of the sons of Yahweh. For the creation was made subject to vanity, not willingly, but by reason of him who hath subjected the same in hope. Because the creation itself also shall be delivered from the bondage of the corruption into the glorious liberty of the children of Yahweh. For we know that the whole creation groaneth and travaileth in pain together until now. And not only they, but ourselves also, which have the first fruits of the Spirit. Even we ourselves groan within ourselves, waiting for the adoption, to wit, the redemption of our body. For we are saved by hope, but hope that is seen is not hope. For what a man seeth, why doth he yet hope for? But if we hope for that we see not, then do we with patience wait for it. Likewise the Spirit also helpeth our infirmity. For we know not what we should pray as we ought, but the Spirit itself maketh intercession for us with the groanings which cannot be uttered. And he that searcheth the hearts knoweth what is the mind of the Spirit, because he maketh intercession for them sons according to the will of Yahweh. And we know that all things work together for the good to them that love Yahweh, to them who are the called according to his purpose, for whom he did foreknow, he also did predestinate to be conformed to the image of his Son, that he might be the firstborn among many brethren. Moreover, whom he did predestinate, them he also called, and whom he called, them he also justified, and whom he justified, them he also glorified. What shall we then say to these things? If Yahweh be for us, who can be against us? He that spared not his own son, but delivered him up for us all, how shall he not with him also freely give us all things? Who shall lay anything to the charge of Yahweh's elect? It is Yahweh that justifieth. Who is he that condemneth? It is the Messiah that died. He rather that is risen again, who is even at the right hand of Yahweh, who also maketh intercession for us. Who shall separate us from the love of the Messiah? Shall tribulation, or distress, or persecution, or famine, or nakedness, or peril, or sword? As it is written, for thy sake are we killed all the day long. We are accounted as sheep for the slaughter. Nay, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him that loved us. For I am persuaded that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of Yahweh, which is in Yahshua, the Messiah, our Savior. I read Romans, the 8th chapter. Let us all say, Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Thank you, Dr. Salas, and thank you, Dr. Love. Tonight is Thursday, and what we always open up the floor for open testimony. So we have some participants out there on Zoom as well. So at this time, if anybody would like to give a testimony, whether in the classroom here or whether out there on Zoom, if you're on Zoom, unmute yourself. Let us know, and we'll give you the floor to give a testimony.
Oh, you talking to us?
Yeah, we're talking to you. Oh. You want to give a testimony? Okay. All right. Well, our first speaker is Dr. Eunice Reiser.
Good evening, class. Sorry, I thought he was just talking to everybody out there in Zoom land. It is an honor and a privilege for me to be here tonight, and I'm glad to know that everybody, all that's able to watch tonight, Yahweh has blessed us tremendously. The scripture, I got to get my Bible. I don't even know where to really start with this, because what in reading this, the scripture, I saw so much of me and what I have just finished going through. And I'm going to just give the testimony, because this has been an experience that I've never had. And I wouldn't have believed it if I hadn't gone through it, and that Yahweh actually showed it to me. You know, he showed me, and the only thing that I can just really relate it to, and I go back and think, when I was get on the floor, I will always be drawn to this garden, and it just seems like it was, I don't know, I was drawn. Well, I found out the reason why I was drawn, because in the run of time, I played this whole role. This Yahweh allowed me to see, and we're still in the month. This dude right here, the mystery of iniquity. See, I had a concept of what the mystery of iniquity was. And I come to find out, Yahweh made him perfect. He is so well, if I can say, in his character. He can deceive the very elect. And that's what I got the opportunity to see with myself. Steph, it's like, I mean, it was like corrupt. Ego, what I thought wasn't it, but it is a powerful delusion. And he is subtle. Yes. I mean, I went through the whole thing. I mean, feeling wise, confused, maybe not even confused. But just being able to do, for the carnal mind is death. And that's what, you know, in your head. That's if you are not, you're not focused in on Yahshua. And I got up on the floor, I think it was a few weeks ago. And I admitted, I was hard-headed. Yahweh said, okay. Since you know that, then I'm going to show you just what you are. And I was going after my own opinion. I listened to the lie that I told myself. Consciousness. It was, but the thing is, I could be just like it says. Ain't no sense in me persecuting myself or going through any kind of changes as such. Some stuff I could say very embarrassing, you know, just speaking it out and talking it out. But when you have to look at yourself as the world, because Adam brought down that mind, and I can dig what mind he had. It wasn't of a concept. He could not see. And it just passed down through all of us. I appreciate it. That's what I needed to know, that I am loved. My brothers here, everybody that is out watching, those that have talked to me, those that have just been patient with me. You know, that's out of love, especially for where I was coming from. And I've done some damage, serious damage. But you know what? Yahweh allowed me to see it, to understand him, told me what I really need to do. And I am willing and ready to do. I have started. It is to learn, not just hear these stories, but to know about these stories. Now I'm into, you know, every little thing. Who is Barnabas? Where did he come from? You know, like the name just showed up there, you know, instead of it being showing up. I go back to pick up where he first came on the scene. It will give me some idea of who I'm talking to, who I'm listening to, who's taking action. Went back with Stephen. Where did Stephen come from? Who is he? I got in the book. I need to know who's doing what, when, and the whole nine yards. I've sat and I've listened to people teach me and say these. And, you know, we read out of the book. But I need to put this on myself and be familiar and know. Because I don't know what we're going to have to do later on as far as this gospel goes. You know, there's still other people that are out there. And it's just pretty much like selfish if I don't even, if I get the message and I don't do anything about it, then I don't have that love in me. So it's time, Yahweh really shook me. He showed me about my car. My car has been held hostage for 7 days. First thing I look at was the creation. Well, the second, when it went in there, it went in on the day of the flood. Then they told me about the control arms. See, these are types and shadows. Put it on myself. My car was, and you know, I got to the point, the craziest stuff that they would say, well, I couldn't get it. Well, normally people would want to really rant and rave. But you know what? I realize Yahweh is causing that to happen for me. So I finally understood. When he say it's ready, then it's ready. That's it. That's all. But I had, until I learned what I had to learn. And I hadn't gotten it all yet either. You know, I mean, but that was the reality part for me to see, you know, that mess that I was born into and war. And some of it was really, like I say, it was, yeah, like corrupt. You know, I could see how Yahshua would not accept nothing like that. You know, and it frightened me too. That was the point of soul losing. There was in here, it talked about, gosh. Let's just, start. Let's go with, go with 7, Romans 8 and 7.
Seventh verse. Because the carnal mind is at enmity against Yahweh. For it is not subject to the law of Yahweh, neither indeed can it be.
And you know what? That is scary. That is scary. The one that brought you in here, even just to say into this teaching, to know that he exists. You know, that is scary. Go ahead.
So then they that are in the flesh cannot please Yahweh.
No, it sure can't. I was not pleased. No. It can't. You know, it's diabolically wrong. Go ahead.
But ye are not in the flesh,
right,
but in the spirit. If so be that the spirit of Yahweh dwell in you. Now, if any man have not the spirit of the Messiah, he is none of his.
Now, this is also a thing that Yahweh has allowed me to see. He allowed me to see the teaching, what is going to be necessary, how we do have to see Yahshua walking down through these charts. I know people, we're going to have to go through these charts. We're going to have to go through Moses. I mean, everybody talk about Moses. Without Moses, we wouldn't know who Yahweh is. Right. So everything is, this principle is set up in here that we all will go through one way or another. You know, and I had to sort of like ease some of the excitement or whatever that I saw. Because Stephanie, my daughter, she really didn't know anything was going on. No, because it was right up here. It wasn't nothing. I looked just as normal as all outdoors. But Yahweh was talking, showing, and explaining. And talking about this garden. But it had to happen, though. See, just like they had to partake up here, they had to in order to come down. They could not propagate up here. They had to come down. And then that's where they start having their children, the heirs. And that's the same thing that I see with myself. That's why I can look and see the things that I manifested. Nope. Don't like the flesh. Yahweh put me through that, but one thing that came out of it is I know what he showed me for an assurity, and it enlightened me on what our job, if not to say our, my job. Now, it whatever, only thing I got to do, what is the scripture? Take my yoke upon you and learn of me. Well, that's it. And all else, he, if anything, whatever comes from, it's his will, not mine. And it will be a pleasure because I don't like this flesh. No, I don't. But anyway, this is where I am now.
11:29.
And every day, you know, it seems that a little bit more is open in my mind about what I've had to see and how, you know, there's a lot of work to be done as far as I'm concerned. Because I see so many different areas now that I need to... It'd be good for me to learn it. Dr. Kinley put all of this here, not for it to look pretty. That's for me to learn the purpose of Yahweh, how he actually broke it down in simplicity, that it can be explained to someone else who may be fortunate enough to hear. Okay.
Matthew 11:29. Take my yoke upon you. 28. Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest.
Right.
Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am gentle and lowly in heart. And ye shall find rest unto your souls.
And that's a thing that I had to learn too, is that I say I am not, you know, I say I'm studying, but I'm not. You can't learn this gospel through studying. Well, evidently, I had a concept that was still up there because it was still happening. And I didn't get it until Yahweh hit me with that. That's still one of those delusionals or those lies that you told to yourself. See, this bad boy, when he fell, he was cast out of heaven. Where was he cast out to? Into the earth plane. Who's in the earth plane? Man. So you think that he's just going to bypass you? I'm afraid not. He didn't bypass him after the flood. So it's nothing any different in the past that is happening now. Yahweh has given us the greatest opportunity to be able to see what they went, and they didn't even know Yahweh. These people, he had delivered the children up out of here, and you would think, wow, yeah, this is, hey, he's cool. Soon as Moses turned his back, oh, hey, we need something to worship. That was just already there. Like our carnal mind is already there. And see, we're smart with this gospel. Oh, yeah, yeah. You hear what a carnal mind is. Right off the bat, you know, my concept steps in there. Instead of going right to the dictionary or going over there, like, what you really mean? What does it look like? You know, you talk about egotistical. Hey, you know, it's about if I don't understand, if it's not even I think I understand, I got to make sure that I do know. For an assurity. Because I don't want to go down that road no more. I ain't going backwards. It's time to just roll. Who is that? I think it's in one of Dr. Kinley's lectures. He say, when you come to yourself, wake up. It's time to wake up. When you come out of this dead consciousness, being unconscious of Yahweh himself, manifesting, and this is the way you got to go. He done said that too many times. Me, I didn't get it. Don't even know whether or not I can't say I was really taught it. But that was part of the purpose too. Part of it. And I think he's a genius. He is a genius, and I'm going to put it that way, because of the way everything is orchestrated and how it just flows. Something happens over here, not knowing 5 or 10 minutes later it's going to connect over here, but it's already going on. It's beautiful. It's beautiful. I'm not gonna, there's things I can say. Okay, do 20. Yeah, 20.
For the creation was made subject to vanity, not willingly, but by reason of him who hath subjected the same.
That's what
hope.
I was just talking about. Yep, just Adam, Eve, we creatures, we subject to vanity. Mm-hmm. You know, that means you ain't got no, you basically like you ain't got no choice. But we have been given the tools to be able to get through it, to know that there's a rhyme and a reason for it, to look for him who has subjected us, and knowing we will be delivered. This is how some of these stories are for us, is to see how not just they fit in according to the pattern, but you'll see some of that pattern with yourself. It should rest with us knowing, okay, well, they're going through the same thing, so they came out all right, then I know I will too. Because the pattern repeats. It doesn't change. And that's a learning lesson. Go ahead.
Because the creation itself also shall be delivered from the bondage of corruption into the glorious liberty of the children of Yahweh. For we know that the whole creation groaneth and travaileth in pain together until now.
And see, we're going to be delivered because the creature itself also shall be delivered from the bondage of corruption and to the glorious liberty of the children of Yahweh. Okay. For we are saved by hope. Let me tell you, hope may be a four-letter word, but hope is a powerful word. I use it quite a bit. I thought it quite, let me say it that way, thought it quite a bit. You know, it got so that Yahweh and I had conversation, I mean outwardly, like somebody was just sitting next to me. I'm telling you. I know people probably thought I was insane. No, that was serious. I had never seen nothing like that before. Never. And I know the satanic spirit is fit. That is Yahweh's, that's Yahweh's, his, yeah. Yeah, yeah. He's bad, bad. You know, if I thought I was, mm-mm, I ain't got nothing. I rest my case, you know. And I did what you were saying, because you never know. If something strike your ear, you know, check it out. Because Yahweh is leaving you a message somewhere. This man was saying about the other night, mortify. Man, as soon as, I guess when I got home, I got into bed, I had to, that came back to my mind. Any kind of weapon would do right about now. You know? I say, hey, my brothers may have the weapon for me. Use it. Use it. So, but, you know, I don't really stay up here that long. And I'm just going to say, I got a lot of work to do. And I know how it's going to be done. And Yahweh will give me pleasure in carrying forth his will. You know, and I appreciate him allowing me to be just the treasurer. You know, it don't mean nothing to me. You know, except for the paperwork, you know. But really, that's what he called me here for. And I look how Reggie was the one that got on the phone and called me. And Reggie was the one that put me off into the position, basically. You know, so we all have our part. We all have our vibe. We do need each other. Because this is Yahweh's purpose. It's all connected. If it wasn't, we wouldn't be together. Yahweh didn't make no mistake. Right now, we're all that we got. We got folks in Zoom land. That's great. It's good to know. It's good to hear the other classes on Zoom. I learn. I listen. And I got some notes and things like that I want to go back through and pull and extract out of them the things that I've learned that I didn't know and how it was run down. And first, and two, I'm going to check the scriptures just like they brought them out. That I know the flow of the story other than just hearing it and it sounding good and sounding right, even though I've heard it before. And they brought up some information today. You know, I'm not going to say it because it sounds like it's unbelievable, but until I can go back and track and find the proof and bring it forth, it'll be good for us all to know. And with that, I thank Yahweh for allowing me this opportunity, for taking me through and bringing me out and placing me on solid ground. And my hopes and prayer is that he continue to allow us and me to see his purpose, pattern, his plan, that we become conscious. Because it's, as we can see, the world is in its turmoil, and it's exit time. You know, like people say, I can just feel it. You know, well, according to the scriptures, yeah, it was something about the seventh age. I forgot what it was, but anyway. So with that, all praises go to Yahshua the Messiah, and I hope everybody enjoy the rest of class.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Dr. Reiser. I'll open up the floor one more time for any testimonies. So if anybody out there in Zoom or anybody in class would like to give a testimony, now's your time. And if not, then we'll call our first speaker for the evening. Okay. Todd Chinook.
All right, good evening.
Good evening.
Sorry I was late. I really am disappointed that I was late. I didn't get to hear all that. But like she said, the devil's not passing over any one of us, and he was really after me today, so that's why I'm late. but what I did get to hear is really encouraging, and still the sense of like wow, there's so much I still got to know. But I heard one of the other classes the other day, and they were saying, if you can get it here, you can get it here. If you can get it here, you can get it here. If you can get it here, you can get it here. Right? So what we say is we need to have a profound. So can we look up the word profound?
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay. I'm going to get out of Miriam. Profound, from Merriam-Webster Online Dictionary. Having intellectual depth and insight. B. Difficult to fathom or understand. 2. Extending far below the surface. B. Coming from, reaching to, or situated at depth.
That's good. That's good enough. Or do you want to? Do you think we should read the next one? Let's go for it.
3. Characterized by intensity of feeling or quality. B. All-encompassing, complete.
Right.
That's as an adjective. And then as a noun, there's one definition. Something that is very deep.
Yes. So, deep. I guess, how do I want to put this? Like you're saying, we're getting the vision in bits and pieces, right? An understanding of it. But there's also another thing that Doc would say is that you if you've got it, you got it all the way. There's no like halfway about it, because 99.9% might be a really good test score, but 99.9% of the truth is still a lie, right? So we've got to have 100% score on this test. And again, like I, because it can't, because for me personally, coming in here thinking that I got to know all this stuff and be able to run the 40 plate chart and all that kind of stuff, it can be daunting and discouraging, you know, at times. So the profound understanding is it can be on any part of these charts. It could be any one of these charts. It, for you were saying Adam and Eve, that was deep, right? You went into that and you felt it with intensity, right?
Yes, I did.
See, and then there, right? Just one little whoosh right there. And that's good enough for some people. May not be enough for others, right? So then that's why we've got all the rest of them. But that's why we're proving it until we are satisfied, right? So we just got to keep going. And then once that happens to you, you don't want nothing else. And that feeling of like, get the men in the white coats, haul me off, put me in the padded room. I am hearing voices. Right? I mean, if you put it that way, like, I hear a voice. But we got to go back to Moses, and what do you start here? He's over here. Well, he sees a burning flame, right? Well, what do you come in here? I don't know. The first thing that jumps out at me is, like, this chart, really. And then they always point out, you know, and this flame going around it all. So he turns aside. So when we come into class, it's like seeing a bush that's on fire, and you turn aside, and you're like, what the heck's going on over here, right? And then what happens? Well, he sees an angel, and he hears a voice, right? Well, what did Adam end up doing? He heard a voice walking in the garden, right? Noah, hearing a voice telling him that you got 120 years to teach the people that there's a flood coming. I mean, you start every chapter of Ezekiel, and the word came unto me. Well, boy, he's hearing voices, right? Hearing voices. And so that's what I think by really deep, what we need to do is get really deep. And that the deepest place you can get is in your own mind. And to have that direct communion, to be able to speak with him face to face as a friend. I guess that's all I want to say about that for now. That was really encouraging, and I'm really happy to hear that testimony. And we could just encouragement. You can get it anywhere in here. You don't have to know it all. You know, we're getting it in piecemeal.
Right.
And some of us will be able to get all of it, and some of us won't. But what you have to do is get it in you. Get this in you. So I brought another transcript today. Is anyone interested in listening to a transcript? Or does someone have, like, something on your minds you want to talk about? It's not a very long one.
Go for it. You tell me the transcript, I could probably try to bring it up on the screen.
Yeah, sure, please. It's Revelation of Yahshua from Heaven. I got a quick drink while you're pulling that up.
I almost did.
All right, you want to start at the top?
I'm just going to start at the top with Dr. Kinley. Does anyone want to be my student body? You'll be the student body, Sean?
Sure. Give me a second while I size out this. That's good enough. Okie dokie. How's this work? Take it away, Doc.
All right. Dr. Kinley, thank you. I know all of you enjoyed the preceding speakers. One thing I want to say is this. If you noticed, they said the same thing.
Wait a minute.
Oh, student body says right.
Oh, yeah, I'm missing something here.
Uh-oh.
Are you on the shorter version that you read last time?
Yeah. Oh, go down. Oh, there it is.
Oh, there it is. Okay, student body. I see it. I'm sorry. I was down here at underneath the title.
All right, no worries. Yeah, yeah, there's a bunch of stuff before
September 18th, that's my birthday.
It's your birthday too? Oh, all right. All right, so I'm going to start over.
All right.
Thank you. I know all of you enjoyed the preceding speakers. One thing I want to say is this. If you noticed, they said the same thing.
Right.
And they saw the same thing. They saw it eye to eye and face to face.
That's right.
Just. And there was no division among them. Now, did you notice that?
Right.
Well, now you know why. It's because they're looking at the same thing, not making any mistakes about it. It's possible. Yes, indeed. It's really possible. You know, I sit there and I thought about many things. One of the things I thought about is this. We could have the thing right in our face, look right at it, and then don't see it or don't understand. Now, to see a thing needs understanding. Now, there's some causes why people don't understand things. You know that? I've heard people say this. Probabilities you have too. Now, if God wants me to see that, he'll have to show me. And you, looking right at it. Dr. Kinley laughs. Now you see how stupid we can be? That's all there is for you to look at. Nothing else. Nowhere you go, in or out of town. Student, Body, and Dr. Kinley laugh. Ain't that right? That's all there is. Now, suppose I say this. Now we have been talking about the revelation of him from heaven, and I wanted to make sure that you understood that. And I'm saying to you, which some of you say, well, I never saw a vision. I don't understand about visions. Now, Dr. Williams has stood there and explained it. But listen, just in case you have never seen one, you will see one. You got one coming, and listen, you'll see it too. And you will be there, and you definitely will see it. If you haven't seen one, you will see one. Now, somebody says, well, I don't believe in a ghost. If you haven't seen a ghost, you will see a ghost.
Ha ha ha.
Somebody said, well, I don't believe it. It don't make no difference. You'll see it anyway.
Ha ha.
Anyhow, how did I do? Dr. Kinley laughs. Yes, indeed. Now, that's what that is. Now, that's what we've been trying to tell you. We've been trying our best to tell you about such things as that so you won't be confused about it. Now, another thing I want to mention here is this. Now, Dr. Williams told you about it, and so also did Dr. Lawford. They told you what a vision was. So, in just plain, understandable words, you know I don't like to think that people are that stupid. Really, I don't. I really don't like to think that people that stupid. Where you can look at a man and you got 33 vertebrae in your spinal column, don't make a difference whether you're male or female, but there is such a thing as a mental derangement or mental deficiency, weak-minded and all them kind of things. But it's better to kind of keep your mouth shut and cover it up a little bit than it is to expose your ignorance. I hate awful bad for everybody up in here to see something but me. It doesn't speak so well of me. Look, like I'm almost ready for the Camarillo. Camarillo's a mental institution. Now that's right. I wouldn't like to think that I was that stupid or stupider than everybody else in here. And I'm sure you wouldn't. Now let's say this. Now we have, as Brother Williams just stated, we have a convention in the state of Ohio. And what I've tried to do in the past year is carry you into the depths, the real depths of everything. And now we've laid a background and a foundation to carry you into those things. Now you resent us getting up here every time, and we turn round and tell you about the same old text and the same old thing all the time. You don't like that. Then when we tell you about something that's pertaining to the same thing, but a different manifestation of it, and an analogy, you said you don't see it. Well, there's nothing else we can do but come right back and tell you the same thing we tell you over and over and over and over and over. We're going to tell you over and over, and you're going to say over and over you don't see it. We can't make no progress that way. Just can't make no progress. Now, the thing is happening under our nose right now that I tried to tell you about. If you have any faith at all or any confidence or any And now, if you don't have no faith and no confidence, if you've got just a type of sense, just a little touch of sense, just plain horse sense, you can almost call it no sense. That's right. Now, when you look into these dispensations and ages, as Dr. Williams has told you about, now, it wasn't long from the creation of Adam here down to the flood. It wasn't too long. And it wasn't so long from here down to the crucifixion. And it wasn't so long from here up to where we are now. Yet, we might think that 1,000 years, a couple thousand years, is a long time. But what I'm trying to say is, the thing I'm trying to get over to you is this. Now, if you're not too stupid, you can see something happened within 1,656 years from here. 2,381 from here to that. You can see that there's something due to happen sometime real soon.
Right, right.
Now, you can be stupid and see that. You can even see that without looking. You can see that with your eyes shut. Now, you know why I said that? Now, I'm going to show you. Now, you look up here. Now, we've been talking about Moses and the children of Israel, and we've been talking about Pharaoh down here in Egypt, how they put the blood on each side of the lintel of the door, and it was dark down there. Well, here he comes along, and he fulfills it. He didn't do this if you'd question whether this was so or not. Get the point? Then, as we go on through this whole entire chart, Now, we definitely sing a song. Is your all on the altar of sacrifice laid? Is that what we sing?
Yeah.
We've got a song, Is Your All on the Altar. Listen, your all is on there, whether you know it or not. You may not know it, but it's there. Now, let me prove it to you. Any scientist will tell you that there's a fire in the center of the earth. Somebody says, blah, blah, blah. Well, if you want to argue, tell me where the volcano eruptions come from. If there wasn't a fire there, see that fire? And the earth is the altar upon which you are on. Now then, the earth that you're upon, there's a fire in the center of the earth, and you're upon the earth. That's no different. That's no different than this altar here. And the fire in that grate, no different. And you are upon the earth. All of you too. Is that right? But now, when we're singing the song, we're not thinking about that. Ain't that right? Singing, is your all? Yes, you're all on there. Everything. We mean something else, as a rule, by what we thought, talking about in that song. But it's all on there. Now, isn't that simple? Simple analogy. Now, watch my thought. Now, the lamb was roasted with fire there and ate it. Now, we talk about Pharaoh down in Egypt. But down here we come. This is just like, let me put it this way. Now I'm going back. See this? Everything made. There ain't nothing else. Nothing here, nowhere, all the way through. Nothing but just repetition, just over and over. That's all this hereby. Nothing else but that. Absolutely, positively, nothing else but that. That's all there is now. So I don't have no other alternative other than to come right back and tell you about the same thing all the time. And it's just doing nothing but functions in the realm of time. Now, I said that to say this. Then if you could see that if we was talking about Pharaoh, Pharaoh is king. And this was of the 18th dynasty. Now, a fellow walked up to me and asked me about, say, the boy just kind of twisted up on it. They don't know whether it's the 14th, 15th, 16th, 17th, or 18th or 19th dynasty. Said, which do you say that it is? I said, well, look, we'll fix it so you won't have to come back no more. And so you can tell. Now, 3 times 6 is 18. Is that right? Right.
Right.
Oh, sorry. And then if 3 times 6 is 18, this has got to be the 18th dynasty. And 3 times 6 is the mark of the beast. Ain't that right?
That's right.
So then, if Pharaoh is the devil down here in the land, then it's got to be the 18th dynasty. So we just fixed it, so there won't be no more squabbling about it. Now, you see it fixed up right here? Vicarius Filii Dei. Here's the man that hath wisdom here. Here is wisdom. Let him that hath understanding count the number of the beast, for it is the number of a man, and his number is 666, 666. 3 times 6 is 18. But that's by adding this plate up and down. Then when you take it over the other way, 666, it's 18 over this way And you remember Satan had that woman bound over like this for 18 years, all bent over like this. And he healed her on the Sabbath day, and the devil just kicked about it. You loosed her on the Sabbath day. That's that 3 times 6, that 18 when Satan is bound in there in Luke. Well, now don't you see that the children of Israel was down in bondage down there? Don't you see that now? Can't you see that? So you don't need real good sense to see things like that. All right, now let me show you this, and here's what I'm talking about. Then we're going to go on home. I'm not going to keep you overtime, not tonight. You can, in fact, quit right now. Yes, indeed. And let me tell you this. I know every time some of you stay out, I know when you get home, you're going to catch hell. I know that. Some from your wife, they won't come. Then the man comes. He ain't home just on time. Don't want you to come in the first place. And it's true with the husband, too. And I know that. I know the problems and all that you have to go through and all. I don't want to abuse nobody because I have to go through the same problems. I'm charged with you. You are the household of faith. And Paul said, he that provideth not for his own household is worse than an infidel. I have to give you something to eat. I have to take care of you. I've got to keep you well dressed and well groomed with the truth. Dr. Kinley laughs. Yes, well fed. We don't want no anemic thing, underweight and all that kind of thing. We want to give you the real genuine thing so you'll have enough when you get home. Now let me say this real quick. Now what's happening as of now, I mean this year 1966-7, there is nothing but a repetition all the way through here. You've seen it plain this year. And now you could just set up and go to sleep. Overlook it. Overlook that just like you do all the rest of it. Now this is a trying time, really trying time. Nothing much in the world, right? People are blind. They can't see that this here man down here, what's his name?
Nasser.
Now you don't even have brains enough to see that the Pharaoh could not retain the children of Israel down there when it was time for them to be delivered. And that man is named, that king, Nasser, ousted King Farouk. Nasser took his place. Now Farouk, if you look at Farouk and Pharaoh, you're not far off. So now, did Pharaoh overtake and pursue and take the Israelites back in there?
No.
Now there's nothing else for you to say. The name is put right in your mouth. There's nothing you can say. Nothing. Well, now it's come down in time for it to repeat itself. And God has set them in there, those personalities in there, just like he set Moses and Aaron and Abraham. He set these personalities in there with the proper names to identify them and correlate them with the events that happened as of now. Now, I want you to look. What is this man that's emperor up here?
Hussein.
What is his name?
Moshe Dayan Hussein.
No, I didn't say here.
Moshe Dayan.
No, that's the general.
Eshel. Eshel.
Levi Eshel. He's the emperor. In other words, he's the king, Levi Eshel. Did you ever hear tell who is the Levi?
Priests.
That's the Levitical priesthood. Is that right?
Right.
Now then, Eshel. Now, do you know anything about Eshel? 14th chapter of Genesis, the 13th chapter of Numbers. Read it when you get home. It's too late now. You got to go home now. You got to go, that's all. So then, now you'll find there in the 14th chapter of Genesis who Eshel is, and Eshel and Levi, and then you'll find them hooked up there with Abraham. Listen, and Melchizedek. So Levi hooked up with the Levitical priesthood, and Eshel with king. And, well, the man is a Levite, and he's the king, or he is the emperor. I mean today, right now, in Israel. Well, now, unless somebody brought you up on that, you wouldn't see it.
That's right.
And yet and still, you're looking at it every day, reading it in your papers. You see the point now? Now, Moshe, see how close to Moses we are? Moshe Dayan. Now, that's the general. That's the fighting man. That fights for Israel and guides their armies. Do you see that? Now then, here is Hussein in here. Then I want you to know that this is Arabian in power. It's not just one little thing, it's scattered out. Now we talk about Babylon. The land down there, Babylon, Media, and Persia. Did you know that Iraq, that's the old Persian Empire? Now when we take this man and standing in through here, look, we got Egypt. the Red Sea, and we got this here that goes along with the chest cavity, and then we got this that goes along the head cavity, and there it is set down there so which you can see it, and you know that that's... Now, we talked about the 6 days in here. You got a 6-day fight up in here and the people involved in it. You read the papers and somebody's saying, well, I don't understand that. Now, isn't that enough to make you sick? That'll discourage somebody. And it's just no sense in you being that stupid. The thing is doing nothing else but repeating. I want to say this in conclusion. You know that Pope Paul VI visited Jerusalem. Now, I don't want to take up no time. I told you that we want to get out of here on time. Now, they received him through that Damascus gate, and he went on down into the city there, and on both sides of the Jordan. He didn't go to Egypt, never went, never sat down in Egypt. But now here's what I want to tell you. Then he spoke at the UN. Oh, yes, I know he's been... This is about the fifth trip. I can name him straight down. Well, I will if it will help you any. He first went to Jerusalem, then he went to Bombay, India... Then he went to where?
UN.
UN. United States. And then he went where?
Portugal.
Portugal. That's right. That's where he went. Then he went to Turkey, where the earthquake was. Now, this is what he's saying. He's saying now that he wants to go back, move the Holy See from Rome to Jerusalem, and build the Holy See in Jerusalem. Now, I got to say this to you, but the clock is on me. But I want to say this to you. You've heard a whole lot in your lifetime about the pre-millennium and the post-millennium, that Christ is going to come back down through the sky and sit on a throne in Jerusalem and rule 1,000 years before the fireworks, before the renovation of the earth by fire. Then you'll have the pre and the post. Somebody say, no, it's going to be burnt first, and then he's going to come. Pre and post. Well, now don't you see that the Pope of Rome is the God of this world? Don't you see that he's negotiated peace, talking about moving the Holy See to Rome, setting up the Vatican there? And people are stupid enough all over the world to believe it. Now, with that 666 on him, he can't do that, because he can't go back into heaven, because Jerusalem beneath is allegorical to Jerusalem above. Now, so far as him coming, jumping down from the sky, can't you see that the Spirit in you, he's coming to all of us, all the time, every day, if we can believe.
That's right.
They that look for him, he will appear the second time without sin unto salvation. He stands at the door and knocks. And here we stand looking up in the sky. Now we're talking about it being revealed from heaven. You will see that vision. It don't make no difference if you're down in the ground or where you are. You will see that vision. But you will not see looking at it with these eyes. When he ascended here, they were not looking at him as a physical man. It don't make no sense. You try going out there and standing on a cloud in a mountain and see how far you get. They, in other words, they said he went in a vision, in a vision. Here, in like manner, it don't make no difference where you are, and then when that happens, you'll be changed in a moment, in a twinkling of an eye. The word of God, which he did that, as Dr. Williams told you, is quick. Powerful is sharper than a two-edged sword, piercing even to the dividing asunder of soul and spirit. Now, I'm trying to my best to tell you that you're right down. Face it, you have to. Dr. Williams told you 1960 was the end. Now you're 7 years deep. God waiting on you 7 years, giving you a break, giving you a break. You still walking around talking about, I don't see it, I don't understand that. I'm even speaking in the other tongue as the Spirit gives utterance. And you don't even know about your own language. And you ought to be able to tell the way you all get along at home and the way everybody is. And the devil, everything he's seen is natural. That's all he can see. He can't see a thing spiritual. Why can't he see? Because he don't have no eyes to see with. Let's go home. All right. So thanks for letting me read that. I want to see in the vision, right? And we talk about the universal revelation, and I just want you to know that, like, we're looking at it right here. It's the vision that everyone has to see. Doc said he didn't get his own special vision. He confirmed Moses and he confirmed John. Right? They saw the same vision. That's what he said, right?
Right.
All the prophets saw the same vision, just from different perspectives. We've all got to see the same vision from our perspective. And that's just what I want to say. This is the universal revelation right here, right now. All right, I'm done. Got anything out of that? Praise Yahweh Elam Yahshua. Hallelujah.
Thank you, Todd, and thank you, Dr. Kinley. For our next speaker, I would like to call on the Dean of the Ontario Branch, Dr. Marlon Love. Dr. Love.
Way. Good evening, class.
Good evening.
Wow, I truly enjoyed the testimonies and the transcript reading there of Dr. Kinley. What was the name of that transcript again?
Revelation of Yahshua from Heaven.
Okay. A lot of things were said and mentioned this evening, and I think needing to see the divine vision and revelation of Yahshua Messiah, which is our study, by which we have seven primary charts, and including a 40-page chart, which depicts events down through time from the fall of Adam, 4,000 years until Yahshua Messiah, correct? That Yahshua Messiah has come into Matthew 5:17 in order to fulfill and bring to an end. Can we have that one read? And can you bring up also Isaiah 28:9-10?
Matthew 5:17.
Mm-hmm.
Think not that I am come to destroy the law or the prophets. I am not come to destroy, but to fulfill.
Now, he's not come to destroy them, but to fulfill them. And we have a certain sect of people that believe that the law and the prophets are still in existence, because they see the destroy. He's not come to destroy them. So therefore, they think to do them. And those are the ordinances and the 613 judgment statutes and origins and laws that they're still trying to maintain, that keeps them in bondage. Correct? Because Yahshua was the end of the law. Correct? Because he died on the cross in order for all these ordinances to be nailed and moved out of the way. And what we have is the apostate church having carnally restored the ordinances that we've experienced and talked about with will and whatnot, right? Mm-hmm. And so you have false prophets, deceivers, denominations, anti-messiahs, false science, theological opinions, religious merchants, Satan's ministers, correct? Latter-day sects, creeds, cults, vain philosophies, etc. Babylon or Christendom, marked of the beast. is what Dr. Kinney has set up here. On one side, that's the apostate, and then you have the church, the victor of the Son of God, being the Catholic Church, the harlot, correct? That sits over there in Rome. And what we've said, that Yahshua is the way, the truth, and the life. For when he, 50 days after his resurrection, poured out the Holy Spirit, correct, on the 120 that were in the upper room. And primarily, you have the 12 apostles, or the 11 apostles at that time, whereby there in Acts, the 9th chapter, we have Saul, being the 12th replacement of Judas, come in, and he was converted, having heard the gospel of Yahshua the Messiah. Because it's by the gospel that we're going to be saved of our consciousness of this ethereal black darkness by which we're all deceived in. And this is the man that set up that purpose. This is the man that is taking on that purpose by way of the will of Yahweh to deceive all of mankind. That's his job. And this is what we've been steeped in. And this is what the denominations and everybody that know not Yahweh are steeped in. And they're hid as a cloak with that mystery of iniquity. And we understand that Yahshua is the way, the truth, and the life, whereby we're dwelling within all this misery, within the darkness. And we know that Yahweh's secret hiding place is the darkness. And therefore, we ought not be afraid of the dark. Mm-hmm. Most children on a scale of whatever are afraid of the dark. Mm-hmm. They don't want to go outside much of the time because of the dark. They don't know. You can't see.
Right.
Unless they have a flashlight or something. Mm-hmm. But yet we're talking about having a knowledge of Yahweh and still abide on earth. Because Yahshua also speaks of Isaiah holding, right? Mm-hmm. And we read Matthew 5 and 17.
Right.
He's coming to fulfill. And fulfill means to complete. And we're of the mind in an agreement that he's completed these laws that were not given to the Gentiles,
right,
but only given as an example for us today, in order to look back at, in order to utilize the scriptures to rehearse this story,
mm-hmm,
over, right, and over, that he just read in the transcript, and Eunice had expressed that we go over, and we're starting at Moses, right, and having come down. And we understand that they came down by way of a promise unto Abraham. And in his land, is his offspring dwelt up in this land for a period of time.
Right.
And at the appointed time, the 70 souls came down into Egypt and tarried here. And meaning when they came down, their brother Joseph was down here as a type of Elohim.
Right.
And so it's at a particular time, they're in this darkness. And over time, they became steeped into that darkness, if you would. Because they were thankful when they got down here, because they had, cause remember, there was a famine that drew them down into Egypt.
That's right.
And it's by that famine that they did not know, mm-hmm, how to feed themselves, how to eat, and how to survive without food.
Right.
So therefore, they had to come to a place at the appointed time in order to fulfill 400 years down here in the Egypt.
Mm-hmm.
Now, that's the setup. And now we're going to have how to get out of this darkness. And it's by the foolishness of preaching the gospel. Isaiah 28 and 9.
Isaiah 28
got a half
nine.
An hour.
Mm-hmm. Whom shall he teach knowledge? Mm-hmm. And whom shall he make to understand doctrine?
Start at 27, please.
Okay.
Chapter 27?
Nope. 28. And verse 7.
7.
Yes.
Okay.
28, verse 7.
But they also have erred through wine and through strong
drink.
Go
through 26. Yep. Who's they? Because we've been taught how to read. So there's certain scriptures, and I'm getting it
five,
so I can get the continuity of the thought so we're clear. When we're talking about whom has he teached knowledge and who is they? So when we're teaching those people that know not Yahweh, mm-hmm. we want to be clear. Because okay. They want to make sure I'm without an excuse. Mm-hmm. I don't know what they was he was talking about, and they, you know, trying to bring up another scenario. Mm-hmm. So we want to catch the continuity of the thought. So we're going to start at 25, I think you said.
28 and 5.
Okay.
In that day shall Yahweh of hosts be for a crown of glory.
That day is today. That day is the day. It's made available by his death. It was made available by the outpouring of the Holy Spirit on that day. Read.
And for a diadem of beauty unto the residue of his people.
A day of beauty for the residue of his people. Not his people on earth. His people that can see him in heaven. Read.
And for a spirit of judgment to him that sitteth in judgment.
And it's a spirit of having the ability to have judgment according to the spirit of the matter. Children of Israel didn't have the spirit in them to be able to judge anything. Todd just expressed, we're in the judgment now. Mm-hmm. Because we've had some 6,000 years to know of Yahweh. And that is according to a vision and revelation that was poured out at Pentecost. Because these people were imposed. Remember, Noah or Moses wrote Genesis, mm-hmm. which includes Abraham, Adam, mm-hmm. Noah, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and then Moses. So how do you figure they were going to understand anything either? Because he's in the vision. He told it by way of a vision. So if we know that the children of Israel were imposed with the 613 judgment statutes and ordinances, and they couldn't do nothing about it because their righteousness would be if they could uphold that law. Mm-hmm. And we know that they couldn't uphold that law now only because of Pentecost. Remember, the 12 apostles were back here in the fourth dispensation. Mm-hmm. They walked with the Messiah for some 3.5 years. And it wasn't until his death, burial, and resurrection and the outpouring of the Holy Spirit that they knew anything about the matter themselves. Remember, Peter didn't know what to do. They was drawing straws for the 12 apostles, not aware. Right. But it was only until the outpouring of the Holy Spirit that they were going to be able to speak. And that we can catch that there in Acts, the second chapter. I don't need to get it. I'm just expressing that that's where they got the enlightenment right. from the Holy Spirit in order to judge in the fourth age today. Because the sixth okay. dispensation's right in the fourth age as well. And therefore, there's a judgment going on whereby we can understand what thus saith Yahweh. Okay. Keep reading here in Isaiah 28 and about 6.
And for a spirit of judgment uh-huh. to him that sitteth in judgment, and for strength to
sitteth
them.
In judgment. Who's sitting in judgment? Yeah. Who's sitting in judgment that has the spirit? Yahshua. But we just read in Romans, yeah. we're the sons
right.
of Yahshua Messiah. Second Philippians talking about have the spirit that was in Yahshua Messiah also be in you.
Right.
Keep reading.
And for strength to them that turn the battle to the gate of the enemy. Mm-hmm. But they
see,
also
if you have we're talking about a battle going on. And is that going yeah, it is Yahshua. It is the Holy Spirit. But it's that spirit in us in order to be able to discern and judge
right.
and turn the battle. Before, we've been running because we did not, like Eunice was expressed, she didn't know which way she was going, wasn't aware and clear, mm-hmm. having to come again and listen again according to a more perfect understanding of what we've all done heard for a number of years. Some got it right. Some got it twisted. Some got it wrong. Now we just got to make it right. Because the pressure coming, the intensity of things that are happening around the world, the movement, the feel of the world is uneasy for a lot of people. I had experience today, my coworker. We talk, hi, bye, talk our work. But after work, come up, very sad, very disheartened about the government and the way things look how things going to be able to carry on. I didn't even make it. I just kept walking. Joshua said, don't say nothing. Joshua said, because I had to move. I had to get to class.
Yeah.
And I've already talked to him about what I believe in. So I'm not going to reiterate it again. But he got pressure. He got a newborn coming. Got one in the belly. And he don't know what he's going to do. And he said, well, you know, if it was just me, I wouldn't care. Yeah, nah, that's not the case. The things that are happening that we are all experiencing are intimidating. And we run from those things because we want to hide in our little secret hiding spots.
Yep.
And not have to turn and do what?
That's right.
Read.
Oh.
Mm-hmm.
To them that turn
yes.
the battle to the gate of the enemy.
Mm-hmm. The enemy. There is an enemy. It's described as Satan or Lucifer. Mm-hmm. Didn't Michael battle with Lucifer? Yep. He had to turn and do something by way of the will of Yahweh to have a purpose.
Right.
We understand that Yahweh had a purpose. Mm-hmm. He had to come down in the shape and form of Elohim. Right? From out of pure spirit, which is incomprehensible, inscrutable, and Yahweh himself said man would not be able to perceive him
right.
in this pure spirit state, which encompasses this entire chart. And everything on the chart is within that cloud.
Mm-hmm.
And likewise, everything in the universe abides within the pure spirit state
right.
of Yahweh. And that's typified by air.
Right?
Right? Keep reading.
But they also have erred through wine and through strong drink
mm-hmm.
are out of the way. The priests and the prophets have erred through strong drink.
Mm-hmm.
They are swallowed up of wine.
Mm-hmm.
They are out of the way through strong drink.
Mm-hmm.
They err in prophetic vision.
Mm-hmm.
They stumble in judgment.
They err in the prophetic vision. And they err in their judgment
mm-hmm.
about the matter. Keep reading.
For all tables are full of vomit and filthiness,
mm-hmm.
so that there is no place clean. Whom shall he teach knowledge?
Now, there's no place clean back here in the wilderness. The judges that were supposed to be judging them, they erred. They became drunkard. They became lost in their ways, and they weren't judging correctly.
Mm-hmm.
Follow? After they come up here in the Canaan's land, they started splitting off. They wanted a king.
Right.
They weren't going to be able to judge correctly. They erred. Keep reading. Now, who's going to do what?
Whom shall he teach knowledge?
Mm-hmm.
And whom shall he make to understand doctrine?
Okay.
Them that are weaned from the milk and drawn from the breast.
Now, a person needs to know what he's expressing. And what we're talking about weaning from are the law and the prophets and the blood, the water, the spirit. This is the milk, if you would. Read.
For precept must be upon precept.
Blood is a precept. And we have the 4,000 years that we can read about in our scriptures that we can pick up the bloodline. That's a precept. It's immutable. It doesn't change.
Mm-hmm.
Read.
Precept upon precept.
Upon precept. It's upon the blood. We're going to have a water principle down through the ages and dispensations, starting with Adam is when you're going to be able to see this water line.
Mm-hmm.
That's a precept upon a precept.
Mm-hmm.
Read.
Line upon line.
This is a line through here, through all the way back and all the way back down is a line. Read.
Line upon line.
Yes.
Here a little
now,
and there a little.
Now we say we jump around. Here a little, there a little. That's that piecemeal that we're getting
right.
of the vision in the divine ordering of affairs by way of the Spirit in order to teach the people. Dr. Kinley said he got the whole kit and caboodle in one viewing.
Yep, right.
And he was able to ingest and become that, if you would, in order to be able to teach his people.
Mm-hmm.
That's the Spirit teaching his people.
Mm.
Dr. Kinley said he didn't exist no more after, so it wasn't a man thinking he's going to create an empire of creatures.
Yeah.
It's the Spirit in him or through him that was going to be teaching the people. Because
right.
as the prayer said, he hoped that the vessel, that whoever speaks, can elevate and say something of edifying nature that will elevate us to see what? Yahshua more perfectly, in order to have faith in Yahshua the Messiah. This is why he's used this pattern of a precept upon precept, here a little, there a little, in order to draw the person's attention to the vision.
Right.
Not
right.
to the story
right.
about the matter,
right.
but to the principal concept of what the book or the scriptures are telling. Because we know in John 5:39 that the scriptures are about that's Yahshua the Messiah.
That's right.
It's not about Moses. It's not about Abraham or none of them cats back
that's
there.
Right.
It's about Yahshua the Messiah.
That's
so
right.
say John, the 5th chapter, the 39th verse.
Yeah.
You follow? But let's keep reading.
For with stammering lips
yes.
and another tongue will he speak.
See, the other tongue is the knowledge of the awareness and the principles of these attributes to be able to see clearly the vision. That's the other tongue. That's the speaking in tongues by which we do say
mm-hmm.
we speak in another tongue.
Mm-hmm.
Mankind does not understand and cannot comprehend when we say express Yahshua.
Mm-hmm.
Number one, they say Jesus. And if they have heard of Yahshua, they don't. Many would not be able to give you the definition of Yahshua.
Right.
Understanding and knowing. Knowing is to have an intimate relationship
mm-hmm.
with the subject matter. And we're going to talk about the subject matter of Yahshua. That's the Holy Spirit. Because they won't put a name of the Holy Spirit with a name. So they're not intimate. They don't understand that tongue of calling the Holy Spirit by a name. They just think it's a ghostly figure or an apparition
yeah.
of some sort of that nature. Put a name on the Holy Spirit, they'll say the Father, the Word, and the Holy Spirit. That's all they figure it is all about. When does the Holy Spirit get a name? Oh, you're talking foolishness. You're talking another language. There you go.
Yeah.
Keep reading.
To whom he said,
uh-huh.
this is the rest wherewith ye may cause the weary to rest.
Now, this is the rest
mm-hmm.
that's already been taken place
right.
of by Yahshua the Messiah. Because he had already carried our burdens all the way down by having performed 4,000 years of persons, places, and things in order to fulfill it. And as Eunice said there in Matthew, the 11th chapter, the 30th verse, take my yoke upon me and learn of me. For my burden is light. It's the same thing he's speaking here.
Mm-hmm.
Right? And then you can catch one more where it talks about in John 17 and 3. Does it not? To inherit eternal life is to know
right.
the one to El and
mm-hmm.
Yahshua the Messiah.
Right.
So now, therefore, there's another witness by which you need to be able to know something about. And know, I'm talking about intimately.
Right.
I'm not saying know of.
Right.
I'm saying to know
right.
about the one true El
mm-hmm.
and Yahshua the Messiah. Don't just be commonplace as though I've heard that name before. And it doesn't really move you to have any kind of edifying or meaning to it.
Mm-hmm.
Just as I would be looking to Jesus, like, what are you going to do you? Can't look it up in the Bible. It has no pertinent definition. It's erroneous. It's a vain name. It's in vain meaning empty. So there's no, I can't get down with an empty, I can't know an empty thing. Otherwise, that's a perversion. That's an imagination. That's a carnal, egotistical, misdirected personality in couched in this corruption. And now that we begin to learn about precepts, upon precepts, according to the scriptures, now we begin to be able to grow about a teacher. Who we going to teach? Read.
Okay. To whom he said, this is the rest wherewith ye may cause the weary to rest,
mm-hmm.
and this is the refreshing.
Yes.
Yet they would not hear.
Yes.
But the word of Yahweh was unto them,
mm-hmm.
precept upon precept,
yes.
precept upon precept. Line upon line, line upon line,
mm-hmm.
here a little and there a little, that they might go and fall backwards and be broken and snared and taken.
That means taken by Elohim, taken captive of Yahshua the Messiah in the spirit according to what he's done set up by way of the blood, the water, or the spirit. And death, burial, and resurrection according to a pattern. Now, what is that pattern? One is to know the unity. 1 John 5 and 7. Then the second is to understand this tabernacle pattern. Because it's by this tabernacle pattern we're going to be able to line up the blood, the water, and the spirit, right? Which are vessels with inside this court roundabout. Then we understand we have a first compartmental veil, which divides the court roundabout from the holy place. The holy place with the three vessels inside of here, all made of gold. And this is the fifth step. And this is the fifth step, whereby you have the blood being one, the altar being two. Come on, let me go back. The gate being one, right? The altar being two, the laver being three, and then the holy cup of anointing oil at the door being four, or the veil. And then in the fifth step being the holy place. And then we understand that there's another second compartmental veil called the second veil is the sixth step. Mm-hmm. And then the entirety of the most holy place is the seventh step. Now we'll have these steps here so whereby we can see these steps throughout these events in time to see the Spirit working, because it's the Spirit through the high priest or the Levitical priest. Because why? You have this type of this anointing with this oil. And it's this oil that's in symbolic of the Spirit, whereby the Spirit is in on the man, because that oil went over all of him. They didn't just dab him,
right,
put a cross on his face.
Right.
You know, they pour the oil over him, and it was saturated in oil in order to perform the function within this tabernacle. Right. And under, yes, sir.
That oil, it only happens once.
Hold on.
So that oil, the holy cup of anointing oil, that, yes, only happens once at the very beginning of their priesthood, right?
At 30 years old, 20 right. years old.
And just once in their lifetime,
yes,
and
sir.
Then it's done. Okay, cool.
Yeah.
I just wanted to make sure.
Yeah, the horn of anointing oil happened once for the high priest. And remember, the high priest, I think they started at 30, and they ended at 50. So that was the duration of their operation within this tabernacle. And so therefore, this is the other key in which we read there in Luke 11 and 1, talking about the lawyers and the scribes took away the key,
right,
to prevent them from entering into the gate.
Mm-hmm.
Now, we talked about the gate earlier there in Isaiah, he having to turn
right.
from the gate, correct?
Mm-hmm. He bowed
at the gate. And then in Luke, grab Luke real quick, 11 and 1. I believe it's 11 and 1. Might be 11 and 12. You scribes and lawyers?
Yep.
Lawyers and I know it's Luke 11.
No? You say 11?
Yeah, I thought it was Luke 11. What was it? 12?
Well, 40.
Down to 40?
Yeah, 39
and 44, I guess. 11:44? 11:39. 39. And Yahshua said unto him, now do ye Pharisees.
11:52.
11:52.
Mm-hmm.
Woe unto you, lawyers,
mm-hmm.
for ye have taken away the key of knowledge.
They took away this key of knowledge because this was the key, Reed.
Ye entered not in yourselves, and them that were entering in ye hindered.
See, they were entering into the gate, and then they prevented them that were going to enter into the gate from doing it. Therefore, Isaiah is talking about back then turning in order to fight at the gate. All right? Keep reading there in Isaiah, please. Because we got this, we understand the principles. And we understand that there has to be a turning of our consciousness, just as Moses, as Todd expressed with Moses here in the holy place of this migratory pattern before it began. He stood in the holy place and took his shoes off, and Moses saw the burning bush, and then he turned in his consciousness to see why the bush did not burn. He wanted to understand. He wanted to know something intimate. He had already seen that the bush wasn't burning. Then he said he went to turn again. No, was he could only be turning within his consciousness. Right. And as we turn to know about Yahshua Messiah. Read.
14. Wherefore, hear the word of Yahweh, ye scornful men.
Now we have to hear the word of Yahweh. It's not the Bible. Where they're going to have that Bible tucked up on your arm and walking around. Mm-hmm. That's not the word of Yahweh. The word of Yahweh is Elohim. Mm-hmm. The super incorporeal being. Read.
That rule this people which is in Jerusalem.
That speaks to this people that are in Jerusalem. Read.
Because ye have said, we have made a covenant with death, and with Sheol are we at agreement.
They made a covenant with death. That first law was the covenant they made with death. Because it was this law that of Moses, when they said all that Yahweh do, we will do, was that a death sentence, because they were not going to be able to perform it in order to live, in order unto salvation. This law or covenant wasn't going to be until salvation, because it was only a type of a purpose that Yahweh has instructed. So now you have to understand the purpose. Can't come down here now and try to wear your garb and not try to do nothing on Saturday because you don't want to go to work. No, that was a time for a then present. Mm-hmm. Keep reading, please.
When the overflowing scourge mm-hmm. shall pass through, it shall not come unto us, for we have made lies our refuge, and under falsehood have we hid ourselves.
See, everything we've been hid, as Eunice said, we didn't hid ourselves since we've been born. Our parents didn't know. We weren't able to teach according to the righteousness of Yahweh. We've been down here in Egypt until we've heard the voice of Yahweh or the word, by way of the word. Read.
Therefore, thus saith Yahweh, Behold, I lay in Zion for a foundation a stone and a tri-stone.
A tri-stone, meaning something that's done experienced, mm-hmm. with that's happened. Read.
A precious cornerstone.
Isaiah is talking about a precious cornerstone, which is Yahshua the Messiah. Read.
A sure foundation.
A sure thing foundation. That's spirit, not a physical man. Mm-hmm. The foundation is spiritual. That is the stone. It's also a stumbling stone unto the Greeks and the Gentiles, unto the Greeks and unto the Jews, this Yahshua the Messiah. But it's a precious stone, Isaiah said,
A precious cornerstone.
A precious cornerstone of the foundation that he built, which is the universe, in order to how to abide in it. And we just read in the transcript that universe is doomed for destruction. As he correlated to the altar. For we know that there's a burning mass in the core.
Right.
By way of witness of a volcano. Keep reading there in Isaiah. I'll finish up a little
he
bit.
He that believeth shall not make haste.
Now you got to believe and make haste. And not make haste, right?
Right.
Okay, read.
Judgment also will I lay to the line. And righteousness to the plummet. And the hail.
Now, plummet means be plumbed up, to be straight, to be straightened up, not crooked in your ways or thinking, but to be straight and understand the perfection of Yahshua the Messiah. Read.
And the hail shall sweep away the refuge of lies, mm-hmm. and the waters shall overflow the hiding place.
And that's the gospel that's going to overflow, not a flood that didn't happen, because he already done did an example, a partial end of the world by way of the witnesses of Noah. And we know what Noah had to do. He had to preach. He had to preach for 120 years. And in order to do what? in order to save the people into this ark. And we understand that this is the first structure that Yahweh had mankind to build. The second being the tabernacle. The third being that temple. And we understand that this ark is a upper deck, a middle deck, and a lower deck. Correct? With one door and one window. Because that's correlating to this tabernacle pattern that's set up as a lower deck, a middle deck, and an upper deck. Called most holy place, and a court round about. Now there's only one door that's 3 feet wide. The gate was 30 feet wide. You understand? That's 33 years until the Messiah's death. The Messiah 33. Didn't he say he's the way, the truth, and the life? So we got this door, we got by this pattern, into this holy place that's always lit in darkness. This place is always lit. Daniel says to stand in the holy place.
Right.
When you see the abomination and desolation, mm-hmm. that's sure to come.
Mm-hmm.
Even though, as Noah said, and they doubted, no rain have we seen. Well, sure enough, Isaiah just talked about hail and rain that's going to be able to do what? Read.
Oh, yeah. Judgment also will I lay to the line,
uh-huh.
and the righteousness to the plummet.
Yes.
And the hail shall sweep away the refuge of lies.
The lies that, what? That Lucifer started everything off with. If he's the main one and we're going to be redeemed in Yahshua the Messiah, the second spirit by way of a quickening spirit that's going to have to be put in your heart and mind, because y'all always say he's going to be the ready writer mm-hmm. with a pen. Within your heart and mind. Not pen and paper, but right. pen within your consciousness. Read.
And the waters shall overflow the hiding place.
It's going to overflow just as this flood overflowed. But this ark rolled on top of that on top of that waters. Right? And it was in there for 110 days. Keep reading.
And your covenant with death shall be disannulled.
Your first man, or that first being that you once were, is going to be disannulled. Keep reading.
And your agreement with Sheol shall not stand.
And your agreement with that death was not going to stand. Read.
When the overflowing scourge shall pass through,
uh-huh.
then ye shall be trodden down by it.
You're going to be, by your own words, just as Pharaoh was trodden down. Trying to chase after the children of Israel down here. That 18th dynasty or that beast man of sin mm-hmm. that you have within ourselves not knowing Yahshua.
Mm-hmm.
Read.
From the time that it goeth forth, it shall take you.
Mm-hmm.
For morning by morning shall mm-hmm. it pass over by day and by night.
Yeah.
And you will be terrified when he will make you to understand mm-hmm. the vision.
He's going to make you understand the vision is the point. Yahweh Elohim, by way of Yahshua Messiah, and by way of preaching through the vessels that understand and can see the vision and revelation, going to have to be made to see. Not set free, made to be free. Keep reading. Anything else there?
For the bed is shorter than a man can stretch himself on it,
mm-hmm.
and the covering narrower than that he can wrap himself in.
You're not going to be able to hide nowhere and find any place to rest, because that bed, as the Messiah said, the foxes have dens, the birds have nests, but the Son of Man has no place to lay his head. And they're like us as sons or fruit of Yahshua Messiah. When we're grown to see the vision and revelation be put into you and written in your heart and mind, whereby you can speak the gospel of Yahshua Messiah. Grab me 1 Corinthians 1 and 26, and I'll end with that. Colossians, I'm sorry. 1 and 26. Yeah. For there's a purpose to it.
Colossians 1, 26. Even the mystery which has been hid from ages and from generations.
And from ages and generations, it's been a mystery. And it's by way of these principles of blood, water, spirit, or the gospel of Yahshua the Messiah, of the death, burial, and resurrection. Read.
But now is made manifest.
It's been made manifest now through the sons, that since the outpouring of the Holy Spirit, has been pouring on the sons of Yahweh all the way down. Read.
to whom Yahweh would make known what is the riches of the glory of this mystery.
Yahweh will make known, or Yahweh will write or make you understand the mystery of this, of his mystery, in due season. Read.
Among the nations. Which
among
is
the world, not just in California or within IDMR, around the world, because, you know, we can run to Matthew, the 24th chapter, and say this gospel shall be preached throughout all the world, and then shall the end come. Mm-hmm. But keep reading there where you're at.
Which is the Messiah in you, the hope of glory.
If you got anything out of tonight's class, all praises to Yahweh our Elohim by way of Yahshua the Messiah. So let us all say hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Dr. Love. That will conclude this evening's lecture. For those of you our Zoom participants, please remain muted until we finish our recording. We don't have any announcements other than we will be having a business meeting on June 6th, Sunday, June 6th. So all of our officers, after class, about 10 minutes after class. So we just want all of the officers to be aware of that. No other announcements. Any and all donations can be had by our treasurer, Dr. Eunice Reiser. We hold classes here at 1816 East Elma Court in Ontario, California, on Tuesdays and Thursdays from 7:30 p.m. to 9:30 p.m. and every Sunday from 11 a.m. to 1 p.m. Pacific Standard Time. Please bring all your friends and all of your enemies, because this is truly the place to learn something about your Heavenly Father. Let us all stand to be dismissed with the doxology taken from the last two verses of Jude. Now unto him that is able to keep you from falling and to present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy. To the only wise Elohim, our Savior, through Yahshua the Messiah, our Sovereign, belong glory and majesty, both dominion and power, both before all time, now and ever. Let us all say hallelujah. I'm sorry.